Something you've talked about, which I think is great, and lots of people don't, but we're getting better, is you've talked about the fact that you do suffer from anxiety. Mm. It's something that you have to live with, and it's something that you...
I also struggled a lot with anxiety and depression.
You did?
Uh-huh.
I have some sort of anxiety, depression, something that's changed my whole life.
I feel like I'm always trying to work through whatever, you know, certain issues are around certain subjects.
Yeah. I think the thing is about anxiety is that it comes in phases and it's different for everybody. And
I really wanted to do well at school to please my parents, to please my family. I didn't really care that much about school.
Personally, again, I'm not like a very outgoing, like social person, like in terms of big groups of people.
I think I pushed myself so far, got to the point where I had a bit of a mental breakdown.
You've got so many things to worry about now, whether you're struggling for exams, whether you're struggling with home life, whether you're struggling with friends, then you have the social media angle. You can understand why, you know, that coupled with the fact that you don't get out of the house because you're staring at a screen the whole time, there's got to be a lot of issues that are going to build from that if you're not careful.
And it's always sold as though everybody else's life is perfect.
Yeah.
That's the problem. And therefore you think if that, oh, you know, everyone else's life is perfect, there must be something wrong with me.
This is the age that we live in. We're not actually communicating with each other. We are unconsciously communicating lies.
For me personally, I think it comes from a place of not ever wanting to come across as an over arrogant person or a person that takes himself too seriously. I'm not always trying to be pretentious or, you know, to say something that I think is going to change the world. I feel like I'm one voice among millions.
I thought that I was completely alone. I also realized how lucky I was and what a wonderful family, wonderful friends I had, but that didn't matter. I wanted the world to swallow me up.
I was not in a good mental place, you know, and I wasn't really dealing with it. I wasn't going to therapy. I wasn't talking to my friends. Nobody knew. I would just go home at night after hanging out with my friends and I would just cry in my bed.
I thought I was going mentally insane. Literally, I thought that from that moment on, for the rest of my life, I was going to be stuck in my head, freaking out without any reason. And I thought I would be the only one that would know what I was really experiencing.
I don't think we're equipped with the vocabulary to understand, because if I walk in here with a broken arm and sit down here, you know.
I say, oh, you're pretty soul, yeah. There you are, what a shame.
Whereas I think people are more than able to, you know, masquerade and they can be going through who knows what.
My mom sat me down when I was probably 18. And when I was 18, said, if you start to feel like you are twisting things around you and you start to feel like there is no sunlight around you and you are paralyzed with fear, this is what it is and here's how you can help yourself. And
I take antidepressant medication for it. I have tried to get off of it. My doctor always tells me not to. That it's not safe for me to. Whenever I've tried to, I've gotten very neurotic, manic, sick.
So I got taken out of school, went to therapy, got put on antidepressants, kind of clawed my way back to some sort of rational thought.
And I, you know, got on a prescription when I was really young to help with my anxiety and depression, and I still take it today, and I have no shame in that.
But as a young mother, actually, said that to me at the Anna Forey Center. She said, actually, just talking to somebody, having those conversations, is like medicine for her.
Yeah.
And that is the point, is that actually, it's okay to have that conversation, even if it is uncomfortable or awkward, but it's just starting it.
Because it's been, say, let's say that it's been taboo, and let's say that we don't speak about it up until more recently, or haven't done. The more that we do, the more we'll learn that it's just a huge circle that we're all on somewhere, and every one of us is experiencing something. So instead of covering it up, why not just accept
it?
And the only way progression is going to happen is by talking about it and by allowing everybody to talk about it, you know. It just becomes more of a normal thing. And hopefully in 10 years from now, nobody is really worried about it. And hopefully 10 years from now, we have better ways of dealing with it because people talk about it and they don't suppress it.
One of the most important things you could realize is that you're not alone. You're not the first to go through it. You're not gonna be the last to go through it. And oftentimes it happens. You feel like you're alone and you feel like it's only you and you're in your bubble
But mental illness and depression is not something to be ashamed of. And I wish at that time I had realized that other people go through it, that I can talk to other people, that you're not alone, you're not an alien.
It's so normal. Everyone experiences a version of anxiety or worry in their lives. And maybe we go through it in a different or more intense way for longer periods of time. But it's not, there's nothing wrong with you. To be a sensitive person that cares a lot, that takes things in a deep way is actually part of what makes you amazing and is one of the greatest gifts of life, is that you think a lot and you feel a lot, you feel deeply, and it's the best. Like, it's
what helped me the most, that I want to impress upon all of you, is that I realize that part of my identity is saying no to things I don't want to do. And you are all in school and you all have a lot of teachers and a lot of people around you that tell you all day what you have to do, but it is your right to choose what you do and don't do. It is your right to choose what you believe in and what you don't believe in. It is your right to curate your life and your own perspective.
The thing that really helps me when I'm having a panic attack now is to just talk to someone while I'm having one. Just for some reason, talking about the way that I'm feeling helps me realize that I'm not actually going insane.
And if you guys are feeling the same way, you know, just be easier on yourself. Don't beat yourself up so much.
And it does get better and easier as life goes on and you start to get to know yourself more and what will trigger certain instances of anxiety and where you feel comfortable and safe. So I would just say, don't ever feel like you're a weirdo for it, because we're all weirdos.
And, you know, my message has always been to accept yourself no matter what, to love yourself, to embrace your flaws. I think flaws are the things that make us special.
Slowly but surely, I remembered who I am. And then you go home and you look in the mirror and you're like, yes, I can go to bed with you every night. Because that person, I know that person. That person has balls, that person has integrity, that person has an opinion, that person doesn't say yes, that person doesn't get a text from somebody and say, oh my God, they wrote this and they sent this emoji, should I write this back? What do you think? Is that okay to say?
Just gotta remember, hold on to that fundamental quality of faith. Have faith that on the other side of your pain is something good.